So the next talk would be by Dr. Shripal Jain, talking about management of MISC lessons learned.
Hi, good evening, everyone. First of all, I would like to thank PCSI for giving me this opportunity to present our experience on MISC and the lessons we have learned from this new disease entity. So the SARS-CoV-2 virus, which caused the COVID-19 infection and was reported earliest in December 2019 from China, led to a pandemic-like crisis within a short span of few months. Most of the children tended to have asymptomatic or mild COVID-19 infection, as very few pediatric hospitalizations and minimal mortality was reported. However, this change as more and more healthy children were being recognized to be presenting with either cardiogenic shock or Kawasaki disease-like presentations, and which were later known to be temporarily associated with the SARS-CoV-2 infection. As a result, WHO and CDC proposed their own criteria for identifying these patients who presented with MISC. In terms of WHO, their criteria included presence of fever for at least 3 days in those between 0 to 19 years of age group and having systemic involvement like either cardiac or gastrointestinal or deranged coagulation profile or presented with hypotension or shock, along with presence of raised inflammatory markers like ESR, CRP or procalcitonin, and presence of either a positive COVID tests in terms of RT-PCR or rapid antigen, or presence of a positive COVID serology, the COVID antibodies like IgG, IgM, or there should be a strong history of contact or exposure to COVID-19 infection. In addition, there should be no other alternative diagnosis to explain the above symptoms. However, the CDC criteria were much more broader and these were intentionally kept this way so as to allow more data collection and help in further refinement of the diagnostic criteria. So the CDC criteria required presence of fever for more than 24 hours in the age group of 0 to 21 years, along with presence of raised inflammatory markers like high ESR, CRP, ferritin, LDH, IL-6 levels or procalcitonin. In addition, they required the patients should be having two or more system involvement requiring hospitalization. So these included neurological system involvement like presence of headache, meningitis, lethargy, cardiac systemic involvement like myocarditis, coronary aneurysms, hypotension, hypoperfusion, tachycardia, or lab evidence of elevated troponin or proBNP, respiratory system involvement like hypoxemia, pulmonary infiltrates on X-ray or CT, and chest pain. Then evidence of thrombocytopenia, neutrophilia or lymphopenia, renal system involvement like hyponatremia, renal failure, or GI system involvement with presentation like nausea, vomiting, abdominal pain, diarrhea, or elevated AST or ALT levels. And this was along with presence of lab evidence of either current or past infection with SARS-CoV-2 virus. Now, this made the job a little easier for us in India, as we also started recognizing cases towards the end of April and May. And presentations were usually divided into three categories: those with mild, having presenting with a febrile inflammatory state; moderate presentation, usually having Kawasaki disease-like presentation; and those with severe, having toxic shock syndrome-like presentation. So as many centers started seeing cases presenting with MISC, 4 centers from Mumbai, we decided to collate our data, and we did the first multi-center study from India on patients with MISC. About 23 cases were identified belonging to MISC, and they were broadly categorized into 2 groups, those presenting with shock and those without shock. Those with shock tended to be older compared to those without, and had breathlessness as their most common presentation. Those without shock had rash, conjunctivitis, extremity changes, or fever as their most common presentation. Another system which was most commonly involved in both the subgroups was the GI system, and most of the patients tended to present with either pain in abdomen, diarrhea, or vomiting. In terms of lab parameters, those with shock from the group 1 tended to have more or higher neutrophil percentage and lower lymphocyte percentage, which was statistically significant. Again, those presenting with shock had higher SGPT levels compared to those without. Serum ferritin was statistically significantly more in those with shock. And as expected, the levels of NT-proBNP and troponin levels were significantly higher in those presenting with shock. Now, this was important for us as it gave information to pediatricians who were practicing in rural areas where bedside 2D echocardiography was not easily available. But however, NT-proBNP or troponin was still feasible in those setups. And decision regarding immunomodulatory therapies could be taken on the presence of these levels rather than relying also on 2D echocardiographic findings. Now, apart from the usual presentations that we were seeing in cases with MIC, there were certain cases who had some kind of unusual presentations also. For example, this child, which was a six-year-old girl who presented with shock, but on 2D echo, we saw what is described as a reverse Takotsubo cardiomyopathy. So as you can see here, the mid LV segment seems to be dilated and fairly dysfunctional. Whereas if we look at the left ventricular apex as well as the base, the function was fairly well preserved at these two segments. Another unusual case, so this was a case of congenitally corrected transposition of great arteries who presented with MIC but also had caudal rupture leading to severe right AV valve regurgitation. Many cases also tended to have some involvement of the pericardium with mild pericardial effusion, but some of them also had large pericardial effusion presenting with tamponade and subsequently requiring pericardiocentesis. As deranged coagulation profile are known in patients with MIC, some of them also had intracardiac thrombus and eventually requiring thrombolysis and long-term anticoagulation therapies. Other unusual presentations involved other systems. For example, there were patients presenting with altered sensorium or Guillain-Barré-like symptoms. Some infants presenting with acute appendicitis or perforation requiring surgical intervention or intestinal obstruction and volvulus. As we started seeing more and more cases of MIC, there were cases which were not MIC but being labeled as MIC, and this creating a complete diagnostic confusion. We burnt our fingers with some cases presenting with features suggestive of MIC but eventually turning out to be enteric fever. So here the positive blood culture cleans the diagnosis. Still, there were cases of dengue and leptospirosis, especially during the monsoon period, which were also being labeled somewhere else as MIC but subsequently turning out to be as either dengue or leptospira. Adenovirus infection, they also tend to present in clusters, and they can have pharyngitis, conjunctival involvement, some cases also presenting with adenopathy. However, cardiac involvement is very uncommon in patients with adenovirus infection. Kawasaki disease, as by now we all know, that can have similar features to MIC, and I'll discuss subsequently how to differentiate cases of MIC from Kawasaki disease. So what were the lessons that we learned from the first wave? Was that coronary involvement is much lesser in cases with MIC, and presence of large or giant aneurysms are even rare. Cardiac dysfunction, however, tends to be more common in patients with MIC. All cases of MIC require therapy with steroids, ranging from oral steroids in mild cases to pulse methylprednisolone in those presenting with shock. IVIG was reserved for those presenting with shock, having cardiac dysfunction or coronary involvement. Ventricular dysfunction recovered in most of the cases by the time of discharge, and it was essential to rule out other infective etiologies as the cause of presentation, since steroids can worsen such clinical conditions if they were not MIC. Coming to differentiating MIC from Kawasaki disease, so this was a study which was published from the Italian Pediatric Society by the Rheumatology Study Group, wherein they studied cases of Kawasaki as well as those presenting with Kawasaki disease-like features but eventually being diagnosed as MIC. So as you can see in this image, the blue lines are the ones showing acute COVID-19 infection. So this was the peak that they had seen in Italy somewhere around mid-March. The red lines are the ones who had MIC and Kawasaki-like presentation, and the yellow are the truly the true Kawasaki disease. So as you can see here, the red lines are actually clustered after the peak of the acute COVID-19 infection, somewhere around 3 to 4 weeks after the acute COVID-19 infections. Whereas the ones with true Kawasaki disease, the yellow lines, as you can see here, they are fairly uniform and show no correlation to the peak of acute COVID-19 infection. In terms of presentation, those with Kawasaki disease has the classical symptoms of conjunctivitis, rash, oral lesions, hand and feet edema, which were less common in those with MISC. Irritability was much more in patients with true Kawasaki disease. Cases with MISC having Kawasaki disease-like presentation tended to have more of abdominal symptoms like diarrhea, abdominal pain, vomiting. Coronary abnormalities were less common in those with MISC compared to KD, and presence of myocarditis, shock, and tachypnea was much more common in cases with MISC. As far as lab parameters are concerned, patients with MISC had significant lymphopenia compared to Kawasaki disease. Their platelet counts were either normal or reduced as compared to elevated platelet counts, which we are often see in patients with Kawasaki disease. Inflammatory markers like CRP, ferritin, D-dimer were much more elevated in patients with MISC, and so were levels of troponin and triglycerides compared to those with true Kawasaki disease. So patients with MISC tend to be older in age compared to true Kawasaki disease, which we, as we all know, tend to be between the 1 to 5 year of age group. GI and cardiac symptoms are much more common in those with MISC. Lymphopenia, thrombocytopenia, again, is more common in patients with MISC, and inflammatory markers and troponin levels tend to be significantly elevated in cases with MISC compared to Kawasaki disease. Eventually, we started seeing presentation of MISC even in newborns. So this was another beautiful study which was published by one of our colleague, Dr. Ravindra Pawar, and his team from Kolhapur, where they started seeing neonates with structurally normal heart but presenting with conduction abnormalities. And all of these newborns had a history of past COVID-19 infection in their mothers. So they came out with their own criteria, wherein all neonates less than 28 days of age who presented with either a lab evidence of SARS-CoV-2 infection in their mother and having the following clinical criteria. So either having severe illness which required hospitalization and presence of two or more organ system affection, or if they had cardiac AV conduction abnormalities along with coronary, with or without coronary dilatation and aneurysm. In addition, they had to have lab evidence of inflammation, and there should be no other alternative diagnosis, like, for example, presence of birth asphyxia or a positive sepsis or a history of or a diagnosis of SLE in the mother to account for the AV conduction abnormalities. With these criteria, they identified 20 newborns. Most of the mothers had positivity for COVID during the third trimester. 90% of the newborns had cardiac involvement, of which 11 patients had arrhythmias, 5 had ventricular dysfunction, and 2 had coronary dilatation and intracardiac thrombi. More than 50% required ventilatory support. So these were the images showing the coronary aneurysms, the mucocutaneous presentation, presence of thrombi, this in this case in the left pulmonary artery and here in the right atrium, and presence of GI system involvement presenting with malignant. These are the ECG images of 5 of their patients showing prolonged QTC interval and subsequent and hence presenting with AV block. In some cases, the QTC interval was as prolonged as 730 milliseconds. And these are the ECG images showing normalization of the QTC interval along after the immunomodulatory therapy. All patients required treatment with IVIG and steroids. 70% required low molecular weight heparin therapy as well. 60% require initial inotropic support. And there were 2 mortalities in this group, one secondary to necrotizing enterocolitis and another to a multi-organ failure. Eventually, we also started seeing fetal cases presenting similarly. So this particular case, this was a mother who presented at term for a fetal cardiac evaluation. So her first fetal 2D echo at around 20 weeks showed her completely normal fetal heart with normal biventricular function. Subsequently, this lady had acute COVID-19 infection, and this was the fetal echo done at about 40 weeks, showing severe biventricular dysfunction in this particular case. These were the cases which were being labeled as fetal inflammatory response syndrome, and they are thought to be secondary to maternofetal transmission of COVID-19 antibodies. They present with prematurity, respiratory distress, severe pulmonary hypertension, cardiac dysfunction. A cord blood interleukin 6 level of more than 11 picogram per ml is an important marker to identify these patients. And as with other cases of MIC, these patients also require therapy with IVIG, with or without steroids. However, a sterile culture needs to be documented before we proceed with immunomodulatory therapy. So from all this, what are the lessons for the future? Positive COVID serology is going to be even more common as we go ahead with these infections. And hence, utility of IgG antibody is going to be really debatable. That's why physicians will need to rely on their own clinical acumen, look at how the disease is progressing, and rely on other lab parameters, especially inflammatory markers, to suspect or diagnose cases of MIC. As with earlier cases, a documentation of absence of bacterial infection will be very, very critical before we consider immunomodulatory therapies. So I hope that with universal immunization, we will soon be able to get rid of COVID-19 and subsequently MIC in pediatric patients. Thank you for your patient listening.